To learn or start a new series, that is GS2 Social Justice. So this paper, it is very important. Why this paper is important? First of all, you have to know the importance of this paper in mains, because if you're preparing this topic or this paper, then it is going to help you in various other papers also. Like you can use the concept from this paper, concepts from this paper in GS4 Ethics or GS1 Society, then GS2 Governance. There's a topic called Governance also. In that paper also, you're going to use the same concept. So the idea is to present the answer. I'll be focusing mainly on answer writing plus lectures, but the smart way of preparation is to prepare a topic and customize it according to the paper. So if a question is asked in social justice, you have to write in a particular way. The same topic, same question, if it is asked in governance, you have to learn the way to write an answer in a governance paper. Like you have to include some commission report, you have to include some articles from the constitution, etc. So that is the basic thing. So that is the importance of this paper. Before getting started, I would request you all to look at all the playlists which are available in this channel. They are specifically designed for UPSC, and these are actually part of our paid courses, but if the response is good here, we'll be considering putting it fully for free here. So please do subscribe and leave a feedback comment. Also, serious aspirants, they can approach Vaishya's WhatsApp. Number is given in the screen. You can buy the test series. It is of very high quality. And you can also refer this channel for any foundational videos. So without any delay, let's get that started. So firstly, you have to have an idea of what are we going to learn in this paper. These are the topics. See, this is the topic, only 6 topics are there. So you're going to put less effort and you are going to have get good amount of questions. One way or the other, this topic will be covered in any of the papers. So this is not going to be a lag in your preparation. So the first topic is vulnerable sections. That is schemes for vulnerable sections. Why this section is important? Because already the paper name is social justice. Social justice is directly impacting vulnerable sections. So to impart social justice or to introduce or to ensure social justice, we have to look at what are the problems of the vulnerable sections, how to target vulnerable sections, what are the initiatives taken by government. That part we'll be dealing in this first episode, this episode. The next thing is second topic is mechanisms, laws, institutions and bodies. Why this is important means whatever initiative government is taking, it is going to be in vain without a regulatory body, without a guidance. So these are the mechanisms, laws, these are the ways by which social justice can be ensured. Then this third episode is specifically for women, children and elderly. We'll be covering this in detail. So this topic is a high probability topic in UPSC. One way or the other, questions will be coming. So we have to cover it. Then fourth and fifth will be dealing. This is actually one topic. We'll be dealing in two parts. Why? Because it is dealing with social sectors. Why social sectors is important? By social sectors, what we mean is education, then health, etc. So these are the social sectors. The difference, that sectors are not social. So by social sectors, we are meaning this health, hygiene, then education, sanitation, like that. Even pollution can be included. So in a social perspective, we have to take every sector and deal it in a social perspective. What are the issues plaguing in this sector? How can we resolve it? That all parts will be dealing in part 1 and 2. Next is poverty and hunger. Why this is important in the context of India means India is a developing country. India is a developing country. So although India has reduced its poverty indications over a period of time, still poverty and hunger continues to be a blockade in the development of the country. So we have to devise new methods, what can be done, what are the new ways to control this poverty and hunger and uplift people from poverty. Then the 7th and 8th sections, current affairs and facts and figures. In this section, in 7th section, what we'll be doing is anything which is left out in the first 6 lectures, the topics related, the current affairs related to these six lectures we'll be covering in this seventh lecture. So what you can do is, whenever there is a topic, whenever there is a current affair related to relating to any of the six topics, you can link that topic. A new current affair you can add. Suppose there is a current affair relating to vulnerable sections. So in this note you can add. You can keep a small bookmark like thing, or you can make a small topic list like thing. So at the time of exam, we'll be finding it easy to revise. And in this way, this current affair, you can enhance your answer writing also. You can give examples, you can give success models, etc. Then comes facts and figures. Facts and figures are very important because it helps in substantiating your answer. So whenever you are beginning an answer, introduction is there, no? So if you are starting the introduction with the facts and figures relating to that topic, that actually substantiates your answer. And it plus it also reveals to the examiner about the level of understanding of your question. So these facts and figures you can use in introduction part and also in the body part. But I would suggest to use in introduction part. We are going to take a look at the concept of social justice. You should be having a very good concept clarity if you have to learn this paper. And this diagram, and these types of diagrams you can use in your mains answer writing also. So the concept of social justice is all about bridging the gap between nominal justice and social justice. This gap is to be filled by good governance. So firstly, what is nominal justice? Nominal justice means all that fundamental rights in constitution which is in paper. All those things will be stated in paper. Like in constitution, we are having fundamental rights, Article 14, equality. But in reality, are we having equality in Indian society? No, never. Then next comes the laws by various states and center. That is also in place. Laws and mechanisms for grievance redressal. That is also not getting implemented fully. So in ideal condition, this two must be equal. This is not going to be equal, but the efficiency of governance. If there is good governance, then we can surely bridge the gap between nominal justice and social justice. If this bridge is gapped, then social justice comes. Now, what is social justice? Social justice comes in a situation wherein people will be having real access. This word is important. Real access and exercise of rights by every citizen. Okay. And this is restricted only by law. There will be no cultural constraints or no other thing other than law to restrict a citizen's equality and a citizen's rational needs. So there exists rule of law. Okay. And there is equitable law enforcement. Equitable is a term very important in social justice. Equitable means in enhancing the population to have a fair degree of competition. Okay. That is the thing. Next, schemes for vulnerable section. Next is the schemes for vulnerable section. And this is the episode 1 of ours, the first lecture. So firstly, who are the vulnerable section? Why we should know this? Because every solution, the optimum solution, always comes from this problem targeting. So if problem targeting and the cause analysis is perfect and it is very precise, then we can arrive at optimum solutions for that problem. So this who becomes important. Who are this vulnerable section? We already know that women, children, transgenders, minorities, disabled, these are traditionally treated as vulnerable sections, and still they are vulnerable only. But there are some emerging vulnerable sections. This is why to target these emerging vulnerable sections, we have to look at proper problem targeting. So who are these emerging vulnerable sections? This is a value addition to your mains answer. Climate refugees are there, technologically handicapped, and educated unemployed class. These are all like emerging vulnerable classes. Why climate refugees? We are facing serious climate change issues, and many island nations, they are at the verge of extinction and they are being displaced. That is a huge problem. So they are also refugees and they are vulnerable. Technological deprivation. This was pronounced during this COVID era, wherein all the services and all the things went into a digital mode and the technologically deprived ones were not able to avail those services. Then this educated unemployed class. India is having a huge chunk of labor force participation rate, but there is not enough employment to be given to these educated graduates and all. Then we have to learn a concept about this stratified vulnerability. Not all people are vulnerable in the same ways. There are different levels of vulnerability. The vulnerability experienced by one person will be different from the other person. There are like levels. Some will be more worse, some will be more pronounced, whereas other will be less pronounced. Then some people will be having double or triple or many levels of vulnerability. Example, you can take the example of SC woman. Here she is having two identities. Being a woman, she will be facing vulnerability due to patriarchal norms, and being in scheduled caste community, she will be facing the vulnerabilities according to that community. So this is a two level vulnerability, stratified vulnerability. Important question: why some sections are vulnerable? Then why this topic is important? Why? Because in any administrative policy or any public policy, the optimum solutions always come from proper problem targeting or problem or causes. We have to target this very well, only then we can reach this optimum solutions. So this why becomes very important here. And this approach, this social factors, legal factors and political factors, no, this is one way of presenting an answer. Like example, if they are asking what are the effects of a phenomenon, let's take what are the effects of patriarchy, then if you are giving like this, if you are presenting your answer like this, social effects are this thing, then political effects are this thing, legal effects are this thing. So you are covering a 360 degree approach to this answer. Like that, if they are asking about any effects, causes or something like that, you can use this approach. So here, particularly with respect to vulnerable sections, why they are vulnerable? So there are social factors. Which are the social factors? Patriarchy, casteism, that you can write. Regionalism is there. Then cultural constraints. Because even if world is embracing values like equality, fraternity, dignity, etc., Indian society is still stuck in the traditional values. And it sometimes transforms into toxic respect also. Then this is an important point: defective socialization of children. Here we are stressing about the parenting tendency. Parenting tendency is not becoming enabling in any ways. So majority parents are wanting to control their students rather than to enable their students to face the vulnerabilities of the society. So this is a serious factor, because the children, they are the asset. Children, they are the human resource. So if they themselves are vulnerable, then the plight of society is going to be serious. Then political factors, why this is important, means to raise a problem, to enforce a law or to enforce an action, you need voice of legal backup. If there is no representation in administrative and political bodies, then who is going to talk about your problems? So vulnerable sections, they are having very low representation here also. Then there are legal factors. Whenever some complaints are being raised, often those complaints are being criticized, or victim blaming happens most often. Like when transgenders go to complain, they are often victim blamed. So there is red tapeism, there is corruption, there is this politics without principles. Politics is becoming without principles. Then there is inefficient monitoring also. Although laws are in place, we are not enforcing those laws to the justice of the vulnerable sections. So this is another thing. There is a need for schemes by state, particularly why we are stressing upon the role of state for vulnerable sections. See, many organizations, many NGOs or many persons, many trust, etc., they are working for the betterment of vulnerable sections. Then why we are stressing upon the importance of state? Why? Because state is like a last resort. State is like a last resort of these sections. State has to guarantee the fundamental rights. 14, 15, it talks about equality. 21, it is right to life. Then 24, exploitation, cultural, educational rights. It is the legal obligation. It is the legal obligation of state to safeguard its citizens. By citizens, we are meaning all the sections of the society. This is a society, and all the sections of the society has to be safeguarded by the state. So the role of state becomes very important. Then you can quote like this: directive principles of state, it talks about the concept of welfare state. By welfare, we are meaning social justice. See, these are all like points which we can add in mains answer writing. This actually gives a flavor to your answer. Then public goods, the concept of public goods. Here itself, in these two lines itself, you're getting two or three keywords: fundamental rights, welfare state, then public goods. These are non-excludable. So who is going to provide it? It is the ethical obligation or legal duty of the state. Then you can quote this Kautilya, concept of Kautilya, king. The king's happiness lies in the citizen's happiness. This you can quote. Then as I have said, this is the sole means, that is last resort, and it enhances the accountability. Then the another point is, it is dealing directly with good governance. The pillars of good governance, ethos, ethics, equity, efficiency, equity, ethics, etc., can't be achieved without ensuring social justice. Then we have to talk about the success probability. Whenever a state is intervening very heavily in a social sector or something like that, then we are going to have benefits out of this. Like here you can quote an example: under 5 mortality, the rate decreased by 49% since 2000, and gross enrollment ratio in higher education also increased. So these are like statistics by which you can substantiate the role of the state. Okay, to look upon the specific problems of each of these vulnerable sections. Okay, vulnerable sections are many in number, like elderly, women, children. So for each of these groups, what are the specific problems? So in case you are getting an umbrella type of question, like what are the issues of vulnerable sections in the society, then what you can do is, you can club in all these problems of the vulnerable sections. But if you are getting a question specifically relating to children and women, then that won't work. So you have to prepare it separately. So here the reasons for vulnerability of children. Firstly, children. What are the issues plaguing children? Firstly, there is a definitional issue. By this we are meaning that according to UN, a child is any person below 18 years of age. But according to the Child Labor Prohibition Act, a children is anyone who is below 14 years of age. So here itself there is a difference. So here itself there is a confusion. Who must be treated as a child? What or privileges must be given? So this is one problem. Then second is the high prevalence of child labor and bonded labor. According to the reports, in the 5 to 11 age group, 48% of child laborers are in the 5 to 11 age group. This is highly serious and highly disproportionate for Indian society. And the highest share of child laborers are working in agriculture sector also. This itself puts them in defective personality development. Okay, so these type of children, they'll be having poor skills and competency. Ultimately they'll be becoming vulnerable in adult. Then there are cultural barriers. Like there is this concept of toxic respect. Children are not opening up their problems to any authorities, be it school or parents or relatives, etc. They are being constantly pressurized to learn new things, to survive in this world of competition. So they are not getting any emotional connect, or emotionally they are becoming handicapped. They are not able to develop a rights consciousness. They are not able to secure a private space of their own. So when these children are coming out from their comfort zone, they feel highly vulnerable. So this is another thing. Then there is this digital traps. We all know about the games like Blue Whale and all, and mobile addictions like these things. Then cyber crimes are particularly difficult to target, plus these cyber crimes are targeting more on children. Okay, so this is another issue. Then there is this climate driven vulnerability. See, this point and all know this point, like this point you can use in mains answer writing. So this is an out of box point. The climatically driven vulnerable children, like you can quote this example as COVID babies, and this example of blue baby syndrome. Blue baby syndrome comes from this groundwater pollution in northern parts of India. So these things, by these things you can enhance your answer. Okay, reasons for the vulnerability of women. Why women are vulnerable? This topic will be having a huge number of points, but then we have to organize those points. So we can quote as some traditional reasons all of you will be knowing. Patriarchy is a barrier to the overall development of women, that is from womb to tomb. This means that right
before the death, before the birth of a girl child, right from the foeticide stage, it is facing discrimination. Okay, fetus stage, it is facing discrimination. Foeticide is there, then it is like a life cycle approach. Life cycle exploitation is there. Foeticide, after that she'll be suffering child marriage. After that, there'll be serious lack of choice, and she'll be pulled on to some financial dependence, and it translates into emotional dependence also. It makes her prone to this domestic violence, dowry system, etc. Okay, so these are the traditional reasons. The new forms of these traditional systems are still manifested in modern world. Then what we can quote as contemporary reasons, there is the serious emotional drain. Why this emotional drain is happening? Because nowadays women are becoming very conscious of their rights, and they are embracing equality, and they are in need to secure an equal and equal space at par with other genders. So this is becoming unacceptable to the Indian society. Okay, so there is this conflict between rights consciousness and unacceptability of the society, and there is this justification of non-traditional exploitation. By in the lens of society, exploitation just means this physical abuse. Emotional abuse is not coming under the garb of exploitation. So this is only traditional forms of exploitation are becoming accepted as forms of exploitation. So how can a rights conscious woman complain about other forms of discrimination? She can't do that. Here the example is dowry system. It is even prevalent among neo-elites, and still this work, the right to work is a choice for women, but it is a necessity for men, and it is a mandatory thing for men. So it is still treated as a choice. If you can go to work, you work. That is women's choice. So here itself there is a discrimination. Then there is this double burden. If a woman is working, then she has to bear this double burden of taking care of her household chores and the workplace jobs. Okay, then this is a new term which came in the wake of this pandemic, COVID-19, shadow pandemic. Shadow pandemic means COVID is there as the visible pandemic. Behind that, during lockdowns, many people were locked in homes. No, so in homes there were serious problems of domestic violence against women. So while this is a visible pandemic, this remains a shadow pandemic. So this point is concerning about the domestic violence against women. Then they are sexually also vulnerable. Okay, this is also a factor. Then there is this health issues. The women, they are not getting access to institutional delivery. That puts their health in risk, resulting in high MMR rates. MMR is maternal mortality rate. Then they are not getting adequate nutrition, which leads them iron, folic acid, etc. It is deficient. It leads to malnutrition, anemia. Then hygiene, menstrual hygiene is very weak in India. These are all the health issues of women. Then the foremost thing is there is a lack of awareness on rights, and many people are not taking any initiative to educate them on their rights. Okay, if they're being educated, they'll be claiming their rights. So there is this lack of awareness on rights. Then many women do not know how to present their grievance, where to go. Even if they go, the authorities, it is not going to respond as such. So there is this grievance redressal problems. Then there is cultural eclipsing of this legal vents. Like, women are always taught to adjust. So a good woman, in the eyes of society, a good woman won't be breaking that barrier. So there is like this, even if some woman wants to seek legal help, she'll be eclipsed by this cultural barriers. So this is another thing. Okay, now here I have given to study the schemes relating to women and children. What you can do is, anyway, in mains they are not going to ask this factual things, what are the schemes, what you can do, that things they are not going to ask. The idea is to know about basic problems of all each of these vulnerable sections. Then whenever you're getting a scheme, you try to give it a mains like approach. Like here I have given one approach. This table like format you can use for prelims also. Here some schemes are given. Samavetana, this is sensitizing action on mental health. So this scheme is particularly relating to mental health. So from this term you have to develop many keywords. Mental health is an important aspect of health. It is a neglected field of health. So it result in ineffective public service delivery of health. So like this you have to develop from this. This is what they are going to ask in means. not particularly any schemes. Like these schemes you have to incorporate in your answers while writing your mains answers. That is the thing. Then this pencil portal, it is relating to child labor. So you have to give some statistics about this child labor. As in the earlier slides, I've shown 48%. Like that, you have to give something. Then what you can quote, it is dealing with Article 24. Then it impacts human resource development, demographic dividend like things. See, this is how you have to write an answer. So simply mucking up the facts won't help you. Okay. Then Ujjwala scheme, it is relating to trafficking. Okay. It is also by Ministry of WCD. WCD means Women and Child Development. Then this Nipun Bharat. Nipun Bharat, it is part of New Educational Policy 2020. It deals with foundational literacy and numeracy. Okay. So how you can write this point? This is new education policy, no? So education is a form of socio-economic mobility. If education is done, then you are going to get economic mobility also. Then there is serious quality deficit in education, and this is mainly impacting the poor children. Why? Because private sector is also providing education, and actually private sector is working more on education in India, education sector in India. So the poor children is not having much access to private sector due to high fees and all. So there is the quality deficit in public sector is going to impact only poor children. So in this way, social justice is ensured. So whenever you're getting some schemes or whenever you're getting some topics, you have to link it with the paper you are learning. If it is social justice, you have to link with the aspects of social justice. That is how you can write an answer. Then this Nirbhaya fund, it is relating to women. Okay. Next is, we are going to tribal communities. Tribal communities is a very, very vulnerable section in Indian society. Why they are vulnerable? So reasons for vulnerability. First thing is the least degree of integration they are having to the mainstream society. While world is moving to somewhere, they are still stuck in this poor technological upgradation. They are adopting primitive methods of subsistence. So that is actually questioning their competitive edge. Okay. And plus they are also facing a lowest degree of social status. They are at the lowest rung of ladder. Then what happens with this? As a consequence of this problem, this intergenerational mobility also gets blocked. Okay. There is a deficit in education, there is deficit in livelihood, etc. So without education, the children, the upcoming generations also feels helpless to lift up the tribal communities from poverty and such problems. So this is a vicious cycle. Then these tribal innovations and models, these are often embraced, like if they are safer methods, tribal medicines and all, they are safer methods, but often they are undervalued and exploited. People are using it and the adequate weightage or adequate value are not given to these innovations many a times. Like we are having many sustainable methods, like water harvesting models of tribal communities is proving to be very, very effective in this era of water scarcity, but still they are not being appreciated for these innovations. Okay. Then they are having legal vulnerability. This AFSPA Act, you know, no? This is an act which gives the power to arrest without warrant. And extrajudicial killings have been reported from northeast areas and all. So this is like a legal vulnerability. They are at a disadvantageous position to take a conflict with these legal authorities also. Then while writing the answer, you can quote this AXA committee findings. You can give committee commission report. If you are giving like that can also substantiate your answer. SACSA committee findings, it is particularly dealing with this tribal communities. It is telling that there is high health burden and diseases like HIV, mental health issues, etc. in tribal communities and in left-wing extremism area, like in the eastern part of India. No, here they are having left-wing extremism. In that areas also, tribal communities are facing discrimination. In terms of discrimination, you can tell that it's malnutrition, mental health issues, etc. Then the lower body size of adult, that is actually a problem of nutrition. So these all things you can write. Then there is this forced migration due to land alienation. Many projects, the dams, then forest acts, etc., actually puts this tribal communities in vain, because they are the culturally bound land. They are very much living with their own tribal customs. So being alienated with this land means highly to them. So it caused heavily to them. So this is this there is this forced migration in place. Okay. Next, when you're looking at the statistics, even this is also a way of answer writing. You can give the graphs like this, where the life expectancy scheduled tribes is only 63.9, whereas rest of India it stands at 67. This is particularly with respect to this COVID time. We have taken this report. Then immunization coverage also, scheduled tribes, they are having very less coverage. Infant mortality also. Okay. On to the schemes for tribal communities. Okay. So first, here what you can do is, you need not mug up all the schemes relating. In a year there will be hundreds of schemes coming up relating to all these communities. So there is no need to mug up all those schemes. They are not going to ask what scheme, the facts they are not going to ask. They will be always analyzing the questions. That questions will be of analyzing type. So what you can do is, for each of the vulnerable sections, so each of that thing, you can make some 5 or 6 schemes and you can link to that answer writing. Okay. Suppose Vandan Yojana, it is adding value addition. Okay. It is about promotion of self-help groups. So here what all you can add, the tribal knowledge is being transformed into self-help groups and it yields economic mobility. Okay. Economic mobility is a main thing relating to tribals. Then it promotes entrepreneurship. It improves the market access of tribal communities. See, this is how you have to link. This is how you have to write. Then this educational schools, Ekalavya schools, what you can write here, it is offering educational mobility. Education is very low in tribal communities. And the main thing here is it is also accommodating tribal customs. So you can use a word here, accommodative justice. These are the key words. So whenever you are writing an answer, from this you develop what is the scheme all about, how you can translate it into mains perspective. That is how you have to write. Then there are these centers of excellence coming up. It is all about strengthening this Panchayati Raj institutions and improving the tribal awareness. Okay. Next is MSP scheme that we are having for rice and all those commodities. 23 commodities are there. But for minor forest produce also, government is introducing this minimum support price. So this is like a right to livelihood. Okay. So this creates a virtual cycle. Economic mobility, it offers a decent livelihood. Then it also offers intergenerational mobility and basic amenities. So it is like a kickstarting of a virtuous cycle. Flow chart. See, these kinds of flow chart you can use in your answer. Better than giving this data kind of things and long answers, if you're giving a flow chart, it is going to look innovative and it is also going to save your time on the exam hall. Okay, at the exam hall. So here this is a vicious cycle, or this is an action plan. Like if somebody found there is an injustice in some system, in the social system, there is some injustice. So some people will be coming together that there is some injustice, and this takes time. Okay. So these people are coming together and they are deciding to organize as a group. Okay. And then after forming a group, they'll discuss they'll educate themselves. What can be done to relieve the social system from this problem. Then the diagnosis takes place. Where are the shock points? Where are the root cause of the problems lying in? Okay. Next, what happens? There is this definition of problem. How can you define this problem? What is the clear dimensions of this problem? Then after here, I have said earlier, knowing the cause after then formulating a solution. Then after formulating a solution, you need an action plan to implement the solution. So action planning takes place. After action planning, the action is actually implemented. Then you have to evaluate the results of this action. Okay. After evaluating results, then this becomes a concretized change. So this malfunction is being corrected. Okay. And after a long period of time, again this malfunction is going to come. So again the second problem again comes. So again the cycle moves on like this. This problem gets fixed and it becomes institutionalized. Okay. This problem is the second problem again fixed and it becomes institutionalized. Whenever there is any fault, again the third problem arises. This again goes through this cycle. So such innovative diagrams you can use. Now here is a practice question See, mains is all, nothing. Mains preparation is void without answer writing practice. So what you can use, what you can try is, you try writing this answer, and in the next class I'll be giving a template answer. Again, there are n ways of writing an answer. The one approach I'll be giving is a template answer. So you can, over a period of time, for many answers you can develop many approaches. Here the practice question is, despite the consistent experience of high growth, India still goes with lowest indicators of human development, and examine the issues that make balanced and inclusive growth elusive. This is a 2019 mains question. You try writing this answer. I'll be giving a template.